Cutaway, a video magazine produced especially for you cable viewers and this cable station. It's a compilation of video clips and features some seen here for the first time. This first edition of Cutaway includes an interview with Bruce Springsteen, a preview of the Mill Valley Film Festival, a clip from Blue Velvet, a salute to secretaries, and backstage at this year's Emmys. All in the next 30 minutes here on Cutaway. Cutaway features the work of Bay Area video producers who work for video companies and local television stations. You might say it's some of their leftovers. Well, leftovers that Cutaway wants to share with cable viewers here in the Bay Area. In future editions of Cutaway, we'll feature student video projects, but for now, we have a good lineup of video to share with you, so let's get started. These first few segments were produced by video producer Herb Bennett. He produced and edited this first piece in honor of Labor Day, seen for the first time in its entirety here on Cutaway.
Thank you.
next montage by Bennett was put together to reflect the events in South Africa. It features some of Reverend Tutu's visit in the Bay Area in 1985.
As a solution, we have never given in to outside demands, and we are not going to do so now.
San Francisco honors its secretaries every year with a few events. This one features some high-tech women having some fun at lunch. Also edited by Herb Bennett.
I see all you strutters are decked out in your Nike high-tech polypropylene business suits, just like I am.
You're watching Cutaway. Herb's next video includes clips from Bruce Springsteen's last visit to the Bay Area and some words from the boss.
Sure, he's the boss. He's in charge.
It kind of gives the feeling of being really American.
I wish I was more like him. Some people call him a god.
What I do is fun, and it's brought me a lot of satisfaction, but there's a, you know, there's a lot of other people that just go about their lives in different ways, and you know, they don't get interviewed or they don't get a big fuss made over them. But I don't think that what I do is just noisier, you know. I mean, sometimes I'll be laying in bed and I'll be thinking that it's amazing. I can't believe it. You know, when I was 14 or 15, I thought about doing this. And somehow I did it, you know. Somehow I got there.
I think a lot of people are missing a lot of the points. They're missing the points of the music. They're also caught up in a sort of celebrity hysteria where one simply has to be there.
I don't know. He's a cute butt.
I don't think he's good looking. I don't like the quality of his voice. I can't hear the words to his songs.
But I would say that he's not original. I think his style is derived from Louis Armstrong through Charles Brown and Ray Charles.
So people do recognize themselves in his songs. They're about situations in which people actually live. He's out there singing with a critical spirit to make people ask questions about where it is they live, what kind of life they're living there.
Somebody that has that individuality, you know, that's willing to get out there and really knock you out, just clobber you like a punching bag over and over again, that does something. I can understand why, you know, how he has caught on finally.
The things about rock and roll is the art of self-creation. More to life than what you see around. That was the most important lesson of my life, you know, and I guess at night, you know, that's the only thing we try to say, you know, or try to do. It's really the only message, real, is you know, don't sell yourself short.
You're watching Cutaway. That was done while Springsteen was last in the Bay Area. He plans to be back in the fall of 86 for a benefit. Next, clips from Joan Collins and other TV personalities backstage at this year's Emmys. This is what we call star talking heads with very little cutaways.
Yes, why do you think your character is so popular all over the world? What qualities do you show that we can all identify with?
Oh, I think it's a woman who never takes no for an answer and who just goes on to get whatever she wants against all odds. And I think that she does have some redeeming qualities, for example, liking her children. And I think they like her, I think they like her dresses. I don't know. I really don't.
Well, my first professional role, my dad produced Shakespeare festivals in Ohio, and he hired me for a whole string of roles over one season. The first one being Master Pinch in Comedy of Errors when I was about 18. Before that, I'd done lots of things, you know, Mustard Seed and, you know, various murdered princes and elves and fairies. But that was the first professional one.
Is Shakespeare a help when you come to appear on television?
Sure. I think any body of acting that you put together helps you out every time you act any role, and the rules are basically the same for television. The logistics change.
Had you had you prepared yourself to win? I mean, did you have
I certainly prepared a speech, and I've been waiting to give my dad a tribute for years. I thought I'd wait for national television and live.
Question. Well, Elsewhere is making out like gangbusters, isn't it?
They didn't get this.
Question for both of you, if I might. Is there a special satisfaction in winning each of you? In other words, they always talk about actors and actresses having a rivalry at home. This sort of smooths it out, doesn't it?
Well, I suppose. Well, thank God she's a woman, or that would really be something,
yes.
Wouldn't it? I mean,
we're up for different parts.
Yes, right. But this is a total shock to me that we both won. I'm very pleased.
It's That's a lot of fun.
Could I just ask as a follow-up before I relinquish this, what is the difference between winning this year and winning last year? Yeah.
Well, this year, half of my concentration is with my wife. Last year, I was alone. I really didn't, believe, you know, that I have to be talking to anybody last year. This year, I was sweating it out for Bonnie. And when she won, I relaxed. And my category was so tough this year, I'm really surprised that I'm up here. But it's happened, I guess. This is a first for us, I know. And I don't know, maybe it's the first for the Emmys. I'm not sure.
I hoped one day I'd get it. No, I'm really not a negative person.
Did you expect it here tonight, coming in here?
Did I expect to get it tonight?
Yeah.
I've learned not to expect anything, but I hoped.
Is it all the more sweet because you had to wait so long?
I think so, yeah. It means a lot more to me now. I mean, if you'd asked me that the years before, I don't know, but it's very special this time. Four must be my lucky number.
These things are hard to describe, but you knew you'd be asked if you won tonight. What can you put into words what it means?
Well, it's not... It is Cagney and Lacey. The person I forgot to thank tonight was Christine Cagney, because she's taught me a lot about life and the work I do. But it's a culmination of 16 years of my being in this business. When I said this is my dream, this was always part of my dream to be acknowledged. I like prizes.
It's a wonderful thing.
I appreciate it. That's about all you can say.
Do you see anyone on television today you look at and you think they really benefited from what I did?
Oh, I don't think the world's ready for anything like I did. There are a lot of wonderful young comedians on the television. One thing you do have to watch out for, it gets worse every year. Right now they're 10 years ahead of schedule. But no, it's a wonderful branch of show business. And it's a great opportunity for any young person who wants to try to go out and make people laugh or to entertain them. That's about all I could say about that.
What was it like being on stage?
It was me. I got up and everything, it was this kind of cross-section between everything slowing down to slow motion and speeding up to, you know, Mach 20. I was going through a million things, but I was just panicking that I might forget somebody. And then, and if I did, you know, everyone who works on the show and all the writers and everything, these guys are brilliant. And it's, I was just happy, Sandy. What can I tell you? You know, I got one of these.
What does it mean to you?
I don't know. I mean, I don't know. I just got my green card 2 weeks ago, finally. And so, like, that's one kind of, you know, I know I'm here now and I can live here for good. And now I know that I'm wanted here. And it's great. I feel great.
How would you describe this isn't a comedy award. How would you describe the comedy on the show? What quality do you feel it has?
I don't know. I think, you know, when you do a situation comedy, there's a necessity that you heighten reality, that you got to pump it, but make it real as you can, but interesting. And so we try to be human, try to be entertaining, try to be sometimes reflective, but I think honesty and I don't know, honesty about what families are all about. And hopefully most of them are funny, because I guess ours is, happy to say.
Okay. Who made you laugh when you were growing up?
My dad, my brother Steve. My brother Steve I forgot to thank too, because he's really, except for all the bad parts of Alex is really my brother, and so I wanted to thank him.
That was some folks you could see on your favorite commercial stations. From time to time, Cutaway will feature clips from TV personalities. We're not Entertainment Tonight, but if contributors have extra clips from the Hollywood scene, you'll see them here on Cutaway. The Mill Valley Film Festival happens during the fall, and each year they produce a film trailer to promote the event. This is this year's.
To some people, work is a kind of discomfort they endure for money. Well, it was for me anyway when I worked at the bank. But after my wife left, and after the drug rehab program, I finally found a line of work I could really enjoy. Anyway, that day I had a screenplay to deliver from the city to this big-time production company up in Marin. And that's when all the strangeness started.
You're probably looking for something more valuable, sir. Like payroll materials or securities. Once they find out it's a screenplay, they'll probably just discard it.
I don't know. I mean, those guys look like they were from L.A. And I mean, stealing a screenplay. Now, doesn't that sound a little weird to you?
I wouldn't worry about it too much.
Yeah, well, maybe he wouldn't worry about it, but I worried about it plenty. I mean, come on, what would a couple of dorks from L.A. want with a Northern California screenplay? I didn't know the answer, but I knew somebody who might.
I only hope you've come in time.
As it turned out, the old man had a real story to tell.
You see, a long time ago, everything about the movies was here. Right here.
In Northern California?
That's right. Now take a look at this. The first moving picture was made by Edward Muybridge in 1877 in Palo Alto.
Really?
Yeah. And Charlie Chaplin made some of his first movies here, near Hayward.
Wow.
Yeah, and the first real feature was made in San Rafael. Even television was invented right here. It was all here. Until they took it away, took it down to L.A.
But you know, they're never gonna believe us.
They will when they see this.
That's how they got Chaplin.
Wow. And Rudolph Valentino.
That's incredible. Hey, wait a minute. Those are the guys that got that film script. Now, who's that?
Douglas Fairbanks.
Wow.
Now, you see how bad things are? Why, they've even put one of their men in the White House. And now they're stealing screenplays from Marin. The final assault has begun.
Wait a minute.
They're coming for the big one, boy. The center of our glory. The gem of the bay.
You mean they're gonna take the 1986 Mill Valley Film Festival?
I'm afraid so.
Like hell they will.
He gave me the evidence. The original negative, so no one could question its authenticity. My job was to get it to Herb Cain. I had a pretty good idea where I could find him. The trouble was, well, someone else did too. I tried to alert the authorities.
Look, I have been transferred from department to department. Would you just get me Mayor Feinstein?
But I guess I was too late.
Hello?
Mayor Feinstein?
Yes, may I help you?
My next move was to try Melvin Belli.
So, we the people of Northern California are seriously thinking of filing a class action against the people of Southern California.
Channel 4 put their best man on the case.
I have a strange and urgent story to tell you about the Mill Valley Film Festival, about Los Angeles and an 80-year history of greed.
He was no match for them.
Evening, guys. Dawg, Sergeant Sauter here for the local search report. Rincon's 4 to 6, sunset's at 5 plus.
It started to seem like our whole culture was being taken. Even Carol Doda.
Is that an Oscar in your pocket? Are you just glad to see me?
They forced me underground. I lived like an animal, filled with terror and suspicion. The festival. The festival. I alone had the knowledge to save it, to save the whole Northern California film industry. But there was no one left to help me. I couldn't let it happen. I couldn't let the 1986 Mill Valley Film Festival go the way of Charlie Chaplin, the Oakland Raiders, and our water.
Surf's up, dude! Soldier time!
Listen to me! Listen! You gotta listen to me! You gotta listen to me! Somebody! Anybody! Listen! They've been ripping us off for years! I got all the evidence right here! You gotta see this! Now, come on! You gotta see the Mill Valley Film Festival before it...
Serving USA...
One of the films the Mill Valley Film Festival premiered is Jim Jarmusch's Down by Law. Jarmusch's last film, Stranger Than Paradise, was a critical success. In Down by Law, three jailmates make a break. John Lurie, Tom Waits, and Robert Virginie are featured in this first clip.
He's Jack.
Seems like we passed his 4 hours. Oh, man, it all looks the same to me. I really can't tell. We've been going around in circles, Jack.
Ragazzi, the boat! The boat! The boat is finished! The water in the boat!
Bail! Bail!
Go in the land! Go in the land!
Give me a leg.
No!
Give me a leg.
Immediately!
Down by Law opened in October and is now being shown around the Bay Area. In this next clip, the trio share a meal on the lamb.
Jack and Zack! I knew! Come on! To eat the animal I have hatched, the rabbit. He ran half an hour behind. Very good. Come on. Jack, come on. Sit down, Jack. I am glad. Sit down the fire. Yes, taste. Yes, taste. Taste, Zack, taste. Eh? Taste. In a moment. of course, I haven't garlic, rosmarino, very important, and olive oil. But it's good, eh?
It's disgusting, Bob.
Yes.
Yes. Bob, it tastes like a tire.
Yeah, I know, it's very good.
David Lynch's Blue Velvet opened in September to mixed reviews. Cutaway recommends it to a mature audience. You might call Blue Velvet David Lynch's Eraserhead in color. Here's a clip.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Blue Lady, Miss Dorothy Valance.
Blue Velvet,
stars. She wore blue velvet, bluer than velvet were her eyes.
As of October, you can see Blue Velvet at the Elmwood in Berkeley. Yeah. On future editions of Cutaway, we'll preview new films and review locally produced projects. Cutaway encourages you to watch your local cable access station, support locally produced TV, watch this channel, and call us with your comments. Cutaway will be back next time with some local video artists and two sleight-of-hand magicians who we hope will keep you from changing the channel. See you next time. This is Vince Flores for Cutaway.